Okay, I studied computer science, but it was not my first love. I got it because of a scholarship. So I did it, and during those days, computer science was the thing. But then I really didn't like it because you had to face computers the whole day. So I took part of the skills and I joined a consultancy. So I started with a little bit of dabbling in computer science and helping them to do programming. But I found myself, loving the consulting part of the organization more. So I got myself more and more involved. So, and then it's a long story, but much later, I got involved in consulting rather than in IT. So it moved from there. So yeah, so it's from there, and then my career's changed course every couple of years. So I am where I am now. So it's quite a far away from computer science. My music taste, pop, rock, hip hop. It's, in the past it was tough, but because of this independent music that has come out, it's become tougher. Actually, not so much because of the artists themselves, but it's because of the platform. In the past, there were many independent artists, even 10, 15, 20 years ago. But the problem was that these independent artists don't have a platform to share. So they have to depend on a record company to be signed and to be famous. But today, if you're an independent artist, all you need to do is just put on YouTube and that's it, you're global. So that has made it tougher for record companies like us to really get a hold of those talents, because now they're everywhere. But they still want to be signed to a label. The only difficulty is that they're not coming to us. So now we have to go out and find them. So that's the only difference. Yeah. Disruption again has always been there. Every 5-10 years or so, things change. So I've lived through the 80s. I don't know how many of you have been through the 80s, but that was when we have changed from cassette tape to CD, to LP, Laserdiscs, and things like that. So those changes were even worse during those times. But I think the thing about an organization or about leadership in that sense is that everybody must be able to adapt. So the thing is that this, the two things, not many companies are ready to adapt. So that means they know that they have to adapt, but they just refuse to, and we all know that, so I won't go down that path. But I think the other thing is about leaders in organizations who have the drive to change. So that is something that is not something easily learned. So, and many people, when they develop their careers, the problem is that either their life is too smooth or too boring. So when they go down that kind of path, they don't suffer, I don't know whether that's the right word, but they don't suffer enough. So if they don't suffer enough in their career growth, they don't know how to adapt. Because they are so there are many leaders today who are very good that if you put them in the normal situation, a normal corporation, normal structure, they can do well. But if if the things change, and in the past they have not gone through changes in their career, they have not tried new things, they have not gone through adaptations earlier in their career, so those leaders will not be effective today because they are not changed. So for us, even if you look at Universal Music today, globally, even like for myself, Malaysia, you'll notice that the CEOs or the MDs that they find for various countries do not necessarily come from a music background. I did not come from a music background, and they purposely choose MDs and CEOs who did not come from the music background in order to change the culture and the DNA of the company to fit. So that's how forward thinking an organization can be. So if you are always from, example, if you're from FMCG, you sell drinks, and every other CEO you look for and every other senior manager you look for are from drink company, you will never change, because that's you're so comfortable with that and the thinking doesn't change. So that's the problem. My work is so fun that it's actually unfair. So my job description is three things. So when I first joined, I asked, what is my job description? So I was being told by my boss, three things are the key on my job description. One, watch YouTube. Second, listen to Spotify. And number three, eat with artists. So that's my job description. I do that every day. So every day I go into my office, I watch YouTube, I listen to music, and once in a while, I eat with artists, and all paid for by the company. So that's really an unfair. So I think that is the highlight of my career. So the ability to interact with artists and to build their careers is something that is very different, you know. So that is, you know, when I first joined, the first week, I had to fly to Hong Kong because I had to go for a private birthday party for Eason Chan. I don't know whether you know who Eason Chan is. So it was a private birthday party for him, and I had to go there because we, you know, he's our artist. And that was within my first week. I haven't even settled down in my office yet, and I had to fly to Hong Kong to attend that. And then he came to Malaysia a week after that, and we had to host him here for two dinners. So, you know, and then he sang karaoke for us privately in the room, and we had fun, we took selfies with him. So that was just the first week. My second week, if I'm not mistaken, it was with Siti Nurhaliza. So I got to, there was a private launch function, so it was, you know, private dinner with her, my wife was there. So, so those are the things. So if you ask me what's my highlight, the highlight now is the ability to do these fun things. And it's part of my job. So it's like you are merging all the fun things that you want to do, and it becomes your job, and people pay you for it. So when you wake up every day, you want to wake up every day because you want to go to work. So that is the thing. Okay, I think in general, the music business, as everybody knows, is a lot to do with the digital side. So again, I won't mention that very much because now all of us are on digital platforms, whether it's streaming, download. So that's become, now physical is still around, but we're talking about CDs and vinyl. People are still collecting those things. So it's still there, so, and it has a role to play. But digital is beginning to climb. And of course, all music companies like us are focusing a lot more on digital. That's one hand. But the other one is coming back to those musicians which you talk about, which are independent, so kind of thing. So a lot of times, the problem with a lot of artists when they go independent is that they don't know what path to take. That means they know what song they want to release, but then how do I get myself regional? How do I sell myself global? How do I get, how do I become more famous? Where do I go 5 years down the road? Now all this, if an artist does not come to people for guidance, they will try to do this their whole life, and they will hit roadblocks and they will hit walls along the way. So this is where, like I mentioned, you know, when we find good artists, potential ones, what we do is that we know that they want to be independent, but we come in and then we partner with them so that they have guidance from us into how they can grow as an artist and how we can help them to become more global and, you know, stuff like that. How to develop as an artist. So those requires a different set of skills which many artists don't have unless they get proper support. Yeah. Okay, I think this comes from the very notion that again, the music industry has changed through the years, and Universal Music particularly has evolved well with regards to this. And what a lot of people don't know is that 3/4 of the artists that we sign today, even in Malaysia, Singapore, where I'm leading, we have so many types of contracts, it will confuse people, but the contracts are so adaptable in such an instance that 3/4 of our artists are on our platform, they are on our label, but we do not impose anything as far as creativity is concerned. They can sing whatever they want to sing, they can write whatever songs they want to write, they can own it. We will then work with them to see which songs can or cannot work, and maybe give a little bit of guidance as to, okay, this will be sound better, this will, maybe it's too niche, can you make it a little bit more mass, or we are saying that, okay, this is not hitting. We will give those guidance and then we will start distributing those songs. So we do not impose anything for many of our artists, but we do provide the guidance if they come to us. So I think that is, like I said, the a lot of artists do not understand where that is. So today I have a lot of young artists who come to us where we bring them into our family, but we do not impose a lot on them. We just tell them that this is the right. What we do is that we also introduce them to, for example, they write a very good song, but to make the song better, they have to find the right team to make the song. Some of them are very good writers, they can sing well, but if they just release it raw like that, it will not go anywhere. So we will introduce them to co-writers, or we will introduce them to producers, or we will introduce them to a good sound engineer so that they get the right sound. Okay, that's one step. And then after that, then we, you know, tell them, okay, we should release this on this platform, like this, like this, like this, you know, and how do we release it? What kind of campaign should, how do we get more Facebook likes? How do we get more YouTube views? So those are the things that we have knowledge all over the world and we know how to boost. So we tell the artist that, do you want to be as big as artist A or artist B? Okay, then follow these steps. But if they still want to follow their own path, that is up to them. But like I said, those who join the Universal Music family, we provide this kind of guidance to them so that they know how to be better positioned to reap whatever they are putting into the platforms. And also to develop them. You know, some of them, like, they can release a very good song, but they cannot find a good second song, third song. Some of them release a very good album, but they don't know how to release a second, third album. Some of them have maybe 10 good songs, but they don't know which song to release first, which song to release second. So there are a lot of these things, it will sound obvious, but when you start to really think about it and when you do it, that's when you start to know, if you are not so experienced, then you start to wonder, is this the right way to do it? And that's if they come to us and, you know, then we can share with them, okay, based on our data. Actually, today we don't use a lot of touch and feel anymore. So we don't say, this song sounds good, maybe it will do well. So we have a lot of data. We have a lot of information because it's digital world, right? So we know what kind of songs will hit what kind of target market. So when we listen to it, when we do some test runs, we actually, we push the song out on digital platforms after a month. There's data enough to tell us that, okay, it should be like this, like this, like this. Let's move this to this platform. Let's put more campaign here. Let's do more Instagram posts. Let's just, you know, do a little bit more on Spotify or Apple, you know, whatever the case is. Those are all data-driven. So it's not a touch and feel kind of environment anymore. And those data and systems is what we have invested in and what we have. Yeah. Okay, we because of our industry, so we work with a lot of young people. And there are two types. One is that those who want to work with us because of, they just want to meet artists and they like to work with music and they like to work in our environment. So we have a number of them working with us. Now we have a lot who they tell us, you know, I don't feel like working on a 9-to-5 kind of job. I don't want to be restricted, like what you said, by corporate, you know. And because of that, we have different kinds of platforms for us. So there are many, the younger generation that we work with now, we work with them. So what they do is we tell them, okay, form an agency. We will sign a contract with you and you become our graphic agency or, you know, or videographer. We have videographers, we have artist managers. We have all this, you know, on our network that because they don't want to work for, they want to work for themselves. So we still engage with them, but on a different contractual relationship. So rather than as a full-time staff, we work with them. They still enjoy the benefits of Universal Music, and many of them, you know, they can still say they are with Universal Music, so that is no problem. So they still, you know, are with us when we meet artists and things like that. The only thing is that they are now their own bosses, and they want to be like that. So it's okay, we're fine, because that is the reality of the world. Yeah, some of those staff that we have came on staff originally, then they start to say, okay, I want to be an artist manager after that. Okay, so they go out and become their own. It's no problem, we still engage with them. We have on the other way around as well, you know, we have got freelancers or contract people who say that I want a more full-time role with Universal. So okay, so we absorb them in. So it goes both ways. Yeah. So yeah, I treat many of these younger sets of people who form their own company, so I treat them as a partner. I don't treat them as a staff. It doesn't matter their age. You know, as long as they are a partner with us, so we treat them equal as a partner. Yeah. What advice? My very first advice is that remember you will die. So I think a lot of young people, they think that they are, the unfortunate mindset is that many young people think they're immortal, as in they will live forever, or they have 20 years, 30 years, and they would never know when something will happen to them. I'm not talking about the two negatives, I'm just saying that that's the reality of life. So that's my first, if that's the only advice I will give, that is what I will say. You know, just remember that each and every day that you are given life, you better do something about it and add value to it. So you just have to think about that, and live is just every day that you don't know when is your next day going to be. So, and because of that, you better make sure that tomorrow is better than today. And whatever you do today to yourself or to whatever it is better than yesterday. If tomorrow you wake up, everything about you is still the same as yesterday, you know, it's that's not right. That's not the right way to live. So the important thing is that it doesn't matter how old or how young you are, especially for those coming out and, you know, have a lot of idealism. So the problem is that, you know, the advice is just tell yourself that every day is going to must be better than yesterday. So just continue, learn more, you know, read more, know more people, understand more, you know, just be a better person every day and you won't go wrong. So that's one advice I will give. The other advice I will give maybe is to say that for young people is that life is not fair. So, and just don't complain about it. I mean, life is never fair to anybody. Because when you think that the other person is good, you do not know what is other bad things that is happening to that person at the back. So whether you are born rich or born poor, it doesn't matter. You know, a lot of things happen to you. Some have extreme cases on one side and some are, you know, they have a monotonous, boring life, but it doesn't matter. The idea here is that life is never fair. So don't complain about it. Just do. Just do whatever you need to do. If you complain about it, you'll never get anywhere. So young people these days, I notice that they like to complain a lot. I don't know why. Maybe it's YouTube or something, but they just like to complain. The moment they wake up, they complain until they sleep. So they need to understand that life is never fair and you cannot benchmark against them. But like I said, you just have to benchmark against yourself. When you wake up every day, are you better than before? Then the third advice sounds better in 3 points. So anyway, the third advice is that when they are starting to build a career, my advice has always been to go wide, dig deep. As in whatever field you are going into, build a wide set of skills and then pick one or two of those and go deep. For example, if this, because we are in employee benefits kind of thing, so most of the people here are HR. So when I speak to HR people, I used to be in HR. So I tell them, if you want to be in HR, for example, you go wide. That means you learn everything about in HR wide as possible. You learn about benefits, you learn about compensation, you learn about IR, you learn about retention, you learn about recruitment, interview, and you go across the board. That's wide. But you pick one or two of these things and then you go deep. And when you go deep, you make sure that, for example, if you want to be really good in retention or recruitment, you take one of those and you become the best in this country or whatever in that field. You go, you dig deep, you dig real deep. And you must be better than anybody else doing this. So when you have this, you won't go far wrong. So whatever field that you're in, go wide, dig deep. That's it.